In this bulletin, Selena Uibo becomes the first Indigenous woman in history to lead a major political party in Australia. Iran summons Australian ambassador over LGBTQI plus post. And a Russian missile strike kills at least 51 people in Ukraine. For the first time in the Northern Territory, a major party has appointed an all-First Nations leadership team. Ngubuyu woman Selena Uibo has become the new Northern Territory opposition leader. Her deputy leader is said to be Yagel Mann and member of Fodali, Tehran Young. It follows a landslide victory in last weekend's election by the Country Liberal Party, who now holds 17 of the 25 seats in the Legislative Assembly. Prime Minister Anthony Albanese says control of youth correctional institutions must remain with the state governments. It comes following the death of a 17-year-old Indigenous male in the Banksia Hill Detention Centre last Thursday night. The young male, who appears to have taken his own life, is the second death recorded in a Western Australian youth detention centre within the year. Mr. Albanese, who discussed the issue with WA Premier Roger Cook on Sunday, says these issues belong under the jurisdiction of the state governments.
It's an investigation that must be allowed to take place. But what I say is, to the call that was there for somehow the Commonwealth from Canberra to run juvenile justice in states and territories is not the way forward. States and territories, people closer to the ground, are in a better position to deliver those services, but the Commonwealth, of course, will always play a constructive role.
The Iranian government has summoned the Australian ambassador in Iran over photos of the LGBTQ plus celebration at the embassy to mark where the Colour Purple Day. Iranian news agency INA reported the foreign ministry summoned the Australian ambassador Ian McConville and condemned the publication of the photos on social media, calling it insulting and contrary to Iranian and Islamic culture and international norms. In response, McConville said that Australia has not insulted Iran or Iranian culture, adding that there was no reference to Iran in the Instagram post. In the caption of the embassy's post, it was written, "Today and every day, we're dedicated to creating a supportive environment where everyone, especially LGBTQIA plus youth, can feel proud to be themselves." Minister for Employment and Workplace Relations Murray Watt says that Iran's reaction is worrying.
Certainly the Albanese government's views and our values are that we support all Australians regardless of their sexual orientation, their gender, their race. And I am concerned to see this reaction from the Iranian government to the activities of the Australian embassy.
Homosexuality is illegal in Iran, but according to a religious decree issued 30 years ago, transgender people can have gender transition surgery. Australia's housing sector is set to face fresh scrutiny by the head of the federal government's Independent Council for the Industry. Chair of the National Housing Supply and Affordability Council, Susan Lloyd-Hurwitz, will lay out her concerns with the country's housing supply and affordability in a National Press Club address today. The speech is expected to center on concerns over the housing market, with concerns of spiraling property prices and not enough action being carried out to create more affordable homes. A major crackdown on the illegal tobacco trade is currently underway, with authorities hoping to combat the gang warfare that's seen more than 100 firebombings across Melbourne in less than a year. It comes as fears grow Victoria's tobacco wars could soon spread into New South Wales, leading to the Australian Border Force to conduct an international crackdown on global crime syndicates. The closing arguments in the defamation trial against Brittany Higgins by former Defence Minister Linda Reynolds have resumed today. The five-week trial, which began at the start of August, is set to be concluded by the end of the day, with Reynolds' lawyer, Martin Bennett, delivering his concluding remarks. On Tuesday, Mr. Bennett began his closing arguments, claiming Higgins had a visceral hatred of Ms. Reynolds, her former boss, and conspired with her now husband, David Sharers, to harm her reputation and bring down the Morrison government. Mr. Bennett has also dismissed the defense's claims that the hurt and distress the Liberal senator experienced was a result of public scrutiny of her actions. A Russian missile strike has killed at least 51 people and wounded more than 200 others in Ukraine's city of Poltava. It's one of the deadliest single attacks carried out by the Russian forces since the war in Ukraine began more than 900 days ago. The Ukrainian Ministry of Defense says that the time between the air raid alarm and the strike was so short that people were still moving into bomb shelters when the strike hit. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky has confirmed the fatalities.
I've received preliminary reports on the Russian strike on Poltava. According to currently available information, two ballistic missiles hit the territory of an educational institution and a nearby hospital. One of the buildings of the Institute of Communications was partially destroyed. People found themselves under the rubble. Many were saved.
Moscow has not yet commented on the attack. In the meantime, Russian President Vladimir Putin has arrived in Mongolia for 2 days of talks, defying a war crimes arrest warrant issued by the International Criminal Court last year. Mongolia is a member of the ICC and is obliged to make the arrest. The Kremlin says it's not concerned he would be detained during the visit, with Mr. Putin's attention instead directed to the prospect of energy cooperation.
The relations with Mongolia are among the priorities of our foreign policy in Asia. They have been brought to a high level of comprehensive strategic partnership.
Russia has been in talks with Mongolia for years about building a pipeline to carry natural gas from its Yamal region to China via Mongolia. Uganda's main opposition leader, Bobi Wine, has been shot in the leg by the security agents in a northern suburb of the capital, Kampala. Mr. Wine, whose real name is Robert Kyagulanyi, is a pop star turned politician who came second in the 2021 presidential elections behind the East African country's leader of almost four decades, Yoweri Museveni. Wine's party, the Platform for National Unity, said in a post on the X platform that security agents made an attempt on his life and that he was seriously injured. The police said that the officers tried to stop Wine and his team from marching along a road, which resulted in a scuffle in which Wine was shot. The police said in a statement on X that an investigation will be conducted to clarify the facts. And back home, Queensland has emerged as the leader in Australia's climate race, according to a study that found the state has accelerated progress on renewable energy production and targets. The environmental report, published by the Climate Council on Wednesday, also praised New South Wales and the ACT for their efforts to reduce transport emissions and gave credit to South Australia and Tasmania for their renewable energy. But the Northern Territory and Western Australia are criticised for their low share of renewable energy and their vague new net zero emissions targets. Queensland was singled out for its progress in clean energy projects in regional centres and its target of reducing 75% of pollution by 2035. The Sunshine State also has the highest percentage of solar panels installed on roofs in the country, with more than 50% of all homes covered. It comes after the Clean Energy Council revealed that Australia risks missing its 2030 renewable energy target if it doesn't commit further in the coming months. And to sport in cricket, Australian men's 2020 captain Mitchell Marsh says he's amenable calls for smaller nations to play more matches against more established cricketing countries. Australia begins a three-match 2020 series against Scotland in Edinburgh tonight. Scotland is a rising second-tier cricketing nation who only narrowly missed qualifying for knockout stages of the recent 2020 World Cup. Marsh cautions he doesn't control the international schedule. But he says the main way for second-tier nations like Scotland to get better is to play against top-tier nations, and that will in turn be better for cricket as a whole.
I think the more cricket that teams like Scotland can play against the bigger nations, the better it is for the world game, and you know, it's our responsibility as players to keep growing the game, so I certainly hope they get more opportunity over the next little period of time.
And now having a look at the weather around the country, Broome, sunny, 31, Perth, showers, 20 degrees, Adelaide, possible late shower, 26, Melbourne, partly cloudy, 21, Hobart, possible shower, 20, Albury, Wodonga, partly cloudy, 18, Canberra, early frost and mostly sunny, 19, Wollongong, mostly sunny, 23, Sydney, some conditions, 22, Newcastle, much the same, 24, Brisbane, partly cloudy, 23, Townsville, cloudy day ahead on the top of 26, Cairns, showers, 28, Alice Springs, sunny, 26, Darwin, same conditions and 35 degrees, and the Torres Strait Islands, partly cloudy day ahead on the top of 29 degrees. And that is NITV Radio News.